people, experiences, and opportunities that make you feel undeserving of the happiness that you truly desire. If you continue to abandon yourself, people will always abandon you. Because you, by you abandoning yourself, you are not giving people the opportunity to fully love you, and you are attracting people that don't fully love you, that only love the version of you that's got it going on, that only loves the version of you that's beautiful, that only loves the version of you that's not depressed, when you know that's not the full picture of who you are. So by you people-pleasing and going into relationships wearing that mask, you are also being emotionally manipulative, babe. It's not just them, it's you too. You are not the victim. You're emotionally manipulating how someone sees you as well. Because you want to be seen as this person on this pedestal. Meanwhile, you don't even think that you're deserving of it. You don't even really think it. It's a false sense of confidence that you've created. It's a mask. Because as soon as somebody says something to you, you crumble. Where's the confidence when someone judges you? Where's the confidence when someone says something about you? Where's the confidence when someone makes an assumption about you? Where's your confidence then? I'll wait. Because that's the reason why you don't want to put yourself out there, because you're scared of being judged, because you're scared of what people... Well, where's your confidence? Because you came into it saying that you didn't give a... I don't give a... Well, okay. I guess you do have some insecurities then. I guess there are some things that bother you. I guess you do have boundaries. And guess what? That's okay. That's absolutely okay. That's the beauty of it. It's okay for you to have boundaries. It's okay for you to have insecurities. Let's get to why you're so insecure instead of so desperately trying to cover it up. Let's talk about why you're so insecure instead of so desperately trying to cover it up. Can we just talk about it instead of running from it all the damn time? Let's just talk about why you're so insecure. Let's just talk about the elephant in the room. You're insecure when you get into relationships. Why? Because I'm scared of my partner deceiving me. Well, why don't you trust? Well, because in childhood, my dad always deceived me. Okay, so it looks like you're replaying patterns. It looks like you're attracting people that remind you of dad, because there's a part of you that took what happened with you and dad personal. The same way that you're taking things personal now. You're internalizing the shit that's happening instead of recognizing that everything that's happening to you is a projection. You're so caught up and not being enough that you're not realizing how powerful you are. You're so caught up in trying to prove your worth to everybody that you're not recognizing that you're already worthy. You're spending so much energy trying to get people to see you in a certain light, not recognizing that who you are in your entirety, light and dark, is enough. It's beautiful, all of you. You wouldn't be the person that you are without your darkness, babe. I go live Monday, Wednesday, Friday, and Sunday at 8:30 a.m. You wouldn't be the beautiful, empathetic, highly intuitive, beautiful being that you are without all the darkness. It's the darkness that made you super empathetic. It's the darkness that made you hypervigilant. It's the darkness that made you very emotionally gifted. You're just blind to it on yourself. It's your darkness that allowed you to be able to see people and really see people the same way you saw mom and dad. And guess what? All right, let me tell you this. Mom and dad saw you seeing them. Did you know that? Mom and dad knew that you saw them. This is why they gaslit you and said, no, you didn't see it. Do you see what I'm saying? Mom and dad knew that you saw them. Mom and dad knew that you were different. Mom and dad knew you were different from the other siblings. Mom and dad knew you were different from the other sibling. Why is this one so outspoken? Why is this one so mouthy? We like the golden child. Where's the golden child that doesn't say anything and just does what they're told? Why are you so mouthy? Why do you see everything? That's what your parents wanted. Why do you see everything? You were so bad growing up. Oh, you mean I was awake? Yeah, you were so bad growing up. You had a mouth on you. Oh, because I called out the truth? No, you were just so combative. You were just, because I knew that things were going on and I was calling it out. Oh, that's what you mean? And so you subconsciously brainwashed me to see you in a different light because you didn't want to be honest with yourself with who you were. So you subconsciously brainwashed me to see you in a different light because you didn't want to be honest with who you were. I was a mirror for you at a very young age. And then you brainwashed me not to be the mirror to make you feel good. And now that I'm waking up and starting to be that mirror again, you don't like it. Now that I'm waking up and being that mirror again and starting to hold you accountable, I'm reminding you of something. I'm triggering you the same way that I triggered you in childhood. But all these years that I found you and jumped through hoops and tried to gain your approval, it fed your ego. It made you feel good about yourself because this person that you've abused, this person that you've put down, this person that you've used as your punching bag all these years is unconditionally loving you and being there for you and putting up with your crap until one day we wake up and we don't want to do it anymore. And then all of a sudden we're selfish and we're acting funny. No, I'm just loving myself. And it seems funny to you because you've never loved yourself. That's why it seems funny, because it's foreign to you. Because you don't know what self-love is. That's why it feels funny to you when I do it. This is why sitting with our darkness is so enlightening. This is why no longer running from your shame is so healing and so enlightening. This is why you go into these dark spaces so that you can come out more clear, more sure, more honest, and you can also teach people to do the same. This is why it's so crucial to stop running from your pain and actually learn from it. Yes, it's going to hurt. There you go. Now you can stop fearing the unknown. Now you can stop fearing the unknown of what it's going to feel like to actually feel your feelings. It's going to hurt. Now you know. Now you can go into it with expectations, since that's what you need all the time because of that shadow of control. Okay? It's time to stop blaming everybody else. Hi, Stephanie. It's time to stop blaming everybody else for why you're not where you want to be, babe. It is not mom and dad. It is not mom and dad. Yes, you may have had some cards that were dealt, but let me tell you, those cards that you were dealt was the exact hand that you needed to have the experiences to actually teach. If you did not have that abandonment wound from mom and dad, if you didn't have that abuse, if you didn't have that sexual trauma, if you didn't have that domestic violence, if you didn't have that drug addiction story, if you didn't have that testimony, then who are you inspiring? If your story was, I was born and I always had money and I never had to struggle and life has always been great and I've never had any adversity and I've never gone through any pain and I've always had everything, that's beautiful and more power to you, but I'm not inspired by you because I can't relate. Your story is more relatable than what you realize. And I heard this last night. There was a documentary. It really touched me. It was by this content creator, Aubrey Marcus. And he had a documentary and he said that there could be 1,000 people in the room. There is oftentimes 1,000 people in a room and they all have the same sadness, the same insecurities. They all have it, right? They all have the same sadness, but no one is brave enough to speak about that. So they all feel alone in that room. All 1,000 people feel alone in this aspect of themselves, right? Right? Because no one's willing to speak up. They have the shame. The shame is holding them back. And so you have 1,000 people in a room together, all feeling alone about this one aspect. And then say one person decides to get up and be brave enough to write a poem or to motivational speak or to say, hey, here's some pain that I've been going through and I'd like to share it. Now, those 1,000 people that felt alone all feel united from one person sharing. And it's making me emotional because that documentary really touched me because I realized that that's me. And so as hard as it is to really sit with this stuff and be brave enough to say, hey, I've been insecure about this. Hey, it's so necessary. You don't know how many people that you're going to ignite and to unite by just one person being brave enough to say, hey, I'm going through this. By one person being brave enough to cry. Oh my gosh, now you guys, I gotta look it up. This is not, is this a cult? It's something, okay, so Aubrey Marcus, so look up Aubrey Marcus, cult. Look it up, because the name is like, he did the name on purpose because like, you have to just watch it for yourself. But look up Aubrey Marcus cult. Like that's the name of the video because like, it's satire, like what he's saying, but like, yeah, you'll see. But like, and I realized that, and you are that, like you are that. And so it's like, yeah, that example really touched me last night when he said that, how 1,000 people in a room can feel so alone in their pain, and until one person is brave enough to just speak about the pain, and then all of a sudden we have a whole room of people feeling united. And so, yeah, it's, I am so just really proud of myself for being brave enough and choosing me and changing these narratives and breaking these cycles of so many people in my life, especially women in my ancestry that did not choose themselves. The long line of people, ancestors, souls that did not choose themselves. And recognizing that I'm having such an emotional response, and it's so hard and it's so scary. Until it's not, until it just becomes who you are, until you just become naturally that person who chooses themselves because they see the value and know the value without having to be externally validated. When you get to the point where you know your worth and you know the value of who you are, you're not scared to have to walk alone. And I think so many of us, if we would have known the value, we wouldn't have been in these relationships that, yes, they provided some type of lesson for us, but they also really hurt our self-esteem. They also really broke down certain aspects of us that we've had to rebuild. And we can do it. We're resilient and we can rebuild and we can adapt. And the human spirit and body is so resilient. It's beautiful to watch it within ourselves, to see, wow, to really reflect and say, I went through some really heavy shit at such a young age. And look where I am. Look where I am. I was not broken. I got lost, but I was never broken. And to really look and say like, wow, I am really brave. And to really relish in that and to look in the mirror and say, like, I'm strong. I've had all these different things that when you really look at it are some painful, heavy things. And when you look at our fellow brothers and sisters that are addicted, and myself included, who is also dealing, have dealt and realized that I deal with addiction, but to, you know, our fellow beings that are living on these streets, riddled with the pain and addiction, recognize that we are not all built the same mentally. Recognize that the resilience and the strength that you have, even though a lot of us say, I'm tired of having to be resilient and I'm tired of having to be strong, recognize how much of a gift the mental resilience that you have is. And that not everybody is strong enough to keep pushing, and not everyone makes the choice to keep fighting. It is a gift to be resilient. It really is. Because some of us, a lot of us, have been through some things that have broken others. Truly. Some of us have been through some things that others have allowed to break their spirit. And we can see it in the streets. In Skid Row in LA, where you see people and you can tell that their soul is just not there. You can tell that their spirit is gone because they've polluted their body so much. It is at such a high toxicity level that the spirit can't even exist. The spirit can't even dwell within them anymore because of how toxic their actual body is at this point. And this is why you see those people on the street and they are not there. And in a way, that's their own protection. It's their own form of dissociation to survive. The body is surviving. If they were aware to how much pain and danger that they were in at all times when it comes to our homelessness, they wouldn't be able to actually function. So yes, the resilience and the strength is a gift. Don't take it for granted. And stop sleeping on it. Stop sleeping on it. Man, who am I speaking to? Myself. Who am I speaking to? Me. But who else am I speaking to? Because this is like, for real. Man, I didn't know. I'm speaking to myself. I'm realizing how much I have chosen others over myself in this lifetime. This is a diffuser with lavender. I realize how much I have chosen others' comfort and happiness over my own. And I realize that that's something I can no longer do. And to really get comfortable and be okay with disappointing others and possibly hurting others, even if it's not your intention, even if choosing yourself means making a different decision, you have to do it. You have to honor it. You're getting to the point where not honoring it is making you feel inauthentic, and not doing things that feel authentic to you is really painful to you at this point. Not doing things that feel true to your heart is just not the direction that you want to go in anymore. And so now you're just like, oh, you're so upset and you're so emotional because you're faced with having to do these uncomfortable things that you've never wanted to do. But you know that even though they hurt right now, it's in your best interest. And you no longer are putting your inner child in positions that are not in their best interest. You made a promise to start protecting yourself and putting yourself first. And that sometimes is at the expense of someone else's feelings or what they want you to do. And that's the shit that's hard with this journey that a lot of people don't talk about, is that you can meet really good people and you can have people that you know care about you, but still have to make decisions to walk away. You know? So, self-love may not always feel good in the moment, but you can't keep letting your ego make decisions for temporary enjoyment. Did you hear me? Listening to your intuition. If you guys get a follow from me or a DM from me, it's not me. Make sure that you just send me the page so I can block them, and then you block them as well. So if you get anyone that's DMing you with my profile picture, it is not me. Okay? Okay. Just please, and if you could, please send me the profile page. If you could. Thank you kindly. Yeah, hey Jake. So yeah, you gotta make these decisions and they're not always easy. And so you can't keep ignoring your intuition and allowing your ego to make decisions for temporary enjoyment. Okay? Yeah. Your ego is making decisions and for the temporary enjoyment right now, but the underlying, you have to address it. Whatever it is, you have to address it. There's not going to be enough joints or alcohol or whatever that is, you have to address it. All the ways that we cope is just temporary. Like, it's just temporary, and the problems are there, and the thought processes are there, and the feelings are still there. You can't get around it. And if you need proof of that, look at some of your parents that are still suffering. Look at some of your parents that are still having so much anger and anxiety. Look at some of your parents that are still so codependent. Look at some of your parents that you know are not happy and that are not really living the life to the fullest. Look at some of your parents that are still so angry and resentful from their parents and how they talk about them still. That is going to be you if you do not do something different. If you don't do something different, then that means that you're following the cycle. If you don't do something different, then that means that you're following the cycle. So how are you going to be any better than mom and dad if you're not willing to actually go for the things that you want? How are you going to be any different than your mom and dad if you don't actually have the conversations with them that they should have had with their parents? I don't know. How are you going to be a better parent with your children if you don't learn how to better parent yourself? You are still parenting yourself. You know that, guys. You're still raising that little child that lives within you. That child that lives within you still needs to be parented by you. That child that lives within you still needs to be parented by you. Because the experiences that you went through in childhood, they're always going to be a part of your psyche, right? They're always going to be a part of your psyche. More than likely get less triggered by it and less reactive by the experiences whenever if someone reminds you of it. You'll have the tools to know how to respond. It won't put you into an oblivion like it used to, but you still will have those experiences and people will still be able to trigger you even 20 years, 30 years after the abuse happens, right? And so when you're in those situations where you're feeling triggered, your inner child is going to need you to be that parent in that moment and speak up for them, advocate for them, set a boundary for them, say yes or no, walk away, let someone go, put yourself in a more healthy position just like you would your own children, right? If you're a parent and you have your own children, you're going to do whatever it takes to make sure that they are in a safe and healthy environment, right? That is your goal as a parent, is to make sure that your kids are in a safe and healthy environment, spiritually, emotionally, physically, and mentally, right? That is the goal, right? Is to make sure that our children are safe, not just physically, but emotionally, because we all know those of us that didn't go through any physical abuse still are having a hard time with the emotional abuse that we went through as children. So even though some of us didn't get a lot of spankings and hits, we still feel just as bruised and beat up from the emotional abuse that we went through as well. So we are trying to create environments for our children now that are safe emotionally, spiritually, because a lot of us went through spiritual and religious abuse as well, which is why we have so much shame that we're carrying right now, because we've been conditioned to think that our sexuality or who we are or who we choose to love or what we choose to do is bad based on someone's idea of what good and bad is. So this is what I'm saying. The shame is coming from so many different directions. And so we have to stop running from the shame that we feel within ourselves. We have to stop running from these thoughts. We have to stop running from it. Do you feel shame because you want to do something a certain way? Or do you feel shame because you've been conditioned to feel shame if you do something a certain way? You were told that you were going to be prosecuted, or you were told that you were not going to have a beautiful afterlife if you made certain decisions. So when you tell somebody that, especially someone who's internalizing, who's impressionable, who's vulnerable, who wants to be good, who wants to do right, when you tell somebody who doesn't have the rationalization skills and the ability to think for themselves, of course, you're going to internalize that. And if you don't ever question that as an adult, you're going to allow that shame to dictate everything that you do, and it's going to cap yourself off from really being truly happy, because maybe something that makes you truly happy is a contradiction of what you were taught you should feel shame about. I was told I should feel shame about this, but how I actually feel, it actually makes me feel good. But it's wrong for me to feel good because I've been conditioned to feel shame. So you see how confused you are in your own emotions? You see how confusing that is for the adult to be like, but it feels good, but I've mentally been told that it's shameful. Everything is telling me that I want to be intimate with this person, but the shame around not being married is stopping me. But everything in my body, everything in my being is telling me that this is a safe person that I really want to exchange this energy. This is someone that I really want to do this with. But the shame of not being married, but the shame of not being married and doing it out. Okay, whose truth are you going to live? If it feels right and it feels good and it makes you happy and you really feel like it's coming from a place of love, then whose truth should you actually listen to? Whose truth should you actually live by? Whose life are you actually living? And are you going to continue living in that shame even though you don't have to? Are you going to continue living in the shame even though you don't have to? Or are you going to be brave enough to say, you can shame me all you want, but I don't shame myself? Just because you think that what I'm doing is wrong doesn't mean that it's wrong. Just because your truth says that you should do X, Y, and Z doesn't mean that it's my truth. Isn't it beautiful to have your own mind? Isn't it beautiful to have your own mind and think what you want to think instead of what somebody is telling you to think? Isn't it beautiful to have the space to make your own decisions and decide what's right and wrong for you? Instead of someone projecting what that is onto you? Isn't it beautiful to sit in that shame and say, hey, you know what? This is actually not my shame. And so then the next time that you choose to love somebody or do something, or the next time that you go to be intimate with somebody that you absolutely love, and even though you're not married, you allow yourself to feel that pleasure. You allow yourself to feel that bliss. You allow yourself to feel all the things that you are deserving and worthy of feeling in that moment. And you stop letting the projection of what someone else told you that you should feel around it matter more than how you actually feel. You see what I'm saying? That is where your liberation comes in. That is where your liberation comes in. Being brave enough to say, sorry, mom and dad, not sorry. Me doing this, me marrying this person, me being with this, me doing what I'm doing may upset you, but it makes me wildly happy. And I'm not living my life for you. I'm living my life for me. So you should sit with the fact that why me doing something that makes me wildly happy makes you upset. You should sit with that. I'm gonna let you sit with that. I want you to sit with why you can't be happy for me. When you can see that I am truly happy. I'm not gonna change and do something that doesn't make me truly happy so that it makes you feel good. Okay? I'm not going to work a job that I hate because it's a job that makes you feel good to discuss with your friends over tea on Saturdays. I don't want to continue being a lawyer because it makes you feel something in your ego to talk with the girls over tea time to say, oh yes, Kristen is in law school getting her degree. I'm not going to be a lawyer because you're too embarrassed to say, oh, Kristen does sound healing and plays music on the weekends out in these festivals, out in the fields for people. Yeah, my daughter, she plays sound healing music at the beach for people who need to heal their chakras. Because that's too embarrassing for you to talk about. I'm not going to do something that makes you feel good. I'm not embarrassed to talk about it. I love what I'm doing, even if it doesn't make sense for you. You know? I'm happy with what I'm doing, even if you think that it's gonna be looked down on in society. I'm happy with what I'm doing, even if I'm not starting off making $300,000 a year. I'm comfortable with the fact that I know that I'll get to that $300,000 a year, but in the meantime, I don't want to sell my soul in order to get there. Even if it takes me a little bit longer to get to that $300,000, $400,000 a year, I'd rather build with my integrity and build doing something that that's meaningful to me and build doing something that I love than doing the same thing, doing what I hate in corporate America. In corporate America, you still have to build. In corporate America, you still have to climb. In corporate America, you don't just start out with, you know, the 5 weeks of vacation. It's something that you grow and build with to have more of those benefits and to have more of the money. So why can't I just build on my own? Because it's harder. Because corporate America already has structure. Because corporate America already has everything laid out so that you don't have to think. Because corporate America has already everything laid out so that you don't have to be in your creativity. You don't have to be creative. You don't have to use the very gifts and the skills that you were meant to have here. You don't have to exercise these parts of yourself that actually make you feel alive. Because by me working for myself, it's forced me to be in my creativity, which has also been so nourishing for my soul and also good for my confidence to know that I can create these thoughts in my head that I know are good and ways that I can create energetic exchanges and ways that I can create abundance. When I actually put my mind to it and I actually believe it and I actually need to do it for my own life, livelihood, when I'm put in that position, I realize that I can show up for myself and I can create abundance and I can pay for a living doing what I love. I'm proving it to myself every single day. Even though I'm not exactly where I want to be, I'm still doing it. I'm still living it. The same way that I was trying to grow in corporate America is the same way I'm growing for myself. But I'm actually doing something that I love. And I'm actually doing something that's meaningful. So don't tell me that you can't make a living and you can't live abundantly doing what you love. I'm doing it. So get inspired and know that you can do it too. I didn't come from money. I didn't have nobody pushing me. I didn't have anyone helping me. I didn't have parents that were super involved. I didn't have parents that believed in me. I didn't have a whole team cheerleading. I didn't have any other things. I'm more like you than you realize. I just had to fight. I've just had to fight for myself. I've just had to fight and not fight anybody but myself. When I say I had to fight, I'm not even fighting anybody. I'm fighting myself. I'm fighting my own beliefs. I'm fighting my own conditioning. I'm fighting my own limitations. It's always been me versus me. Whether I was conscious, whether I was aware of it or not, it's always been me versus me because I was the main one making the decisions, whether it was subconscious or conscious. I was the ones that were entertaining their relationships, whether it was conscious or subconscious. I was the one that was continuing to allow dad to trigger me into oblivion, whether it was conscious or unconscious. I was the one that was deciding that my feelings were not valid, whether it was conscious or unconscious. I was the one that saying that I wasn't allowed to have a healthy relationship, whether it was conscious or unconscious. I was the one that believed that I was not worthy of love, whether it was conscious or unconscious. It was me. That's what I'm trying to say. It's you. Whether you were aware of it or not, it was still you. It was still something that you believed in childhood that was not true, whether it was a conditioning or not. It's still up to you to break out of it. It's still up to you to reprogram your mind to believe something different. If you no longer resonate with being the shy, quiet person and you want to be, and you know in your bones, you want to be someone who's more embodied, who embodies more confidence and speaks up, then start doing that. You're not going to become the confident, outspoken person by continuing to still be small and quiet. You have to break out of your comfort zone at some point. At some point, you're going to have to just do it. At some point, you're going to have to rip the Band-Aid off. You're never going to allow yourself to be comfortable without being uncomfortable. The duality is there. You have to face your fears. It is a part of your mission because a part of your mission is to help inspire other people to know that they can do the same. That's why you have such a call to do it. Why would you be putting yourself through the anxious and anxiety anguish to be like, I know I need to show up. I know I need to start building my YouTube. I know I need to get this out. Why would you be doing it if it wasn't for a bigger reason? If it was just for you, you don't need to do that. I don't need to come on here and talk and tell my story the same thing every day. I'm aware of it. I've healed it. I'm in a different place. The things that I'm channeling and talking to you about, a lot of times I'm not even in that place anymore. It's because it's my calling. It's my yearning desire to tell my story because I know that people need to hear it. I know that my story is going to inspire other people to share their story and set themselves free. I know how much sharing my truth has been so healing for my soul because I am physically releasing all of the darkness through my words and not just transferring it onto other people like I used to do in relationships. Yep, when I was toxic, I'm not just transferring all this shit onto other people and making them feel like they're not enough. I am transmuting it and using my darkness to be the light. I am using my darkness to be the light and to show you that you can do the same thing. You can do the same thing with your darkness, that you don't have to allow your darkness to control you anymore. You don't have to allow your insecurities to control the way that you show up anymore. You get to show up and be yourself. And guess what? You get to be confident in your insecurities. Yes, you do have insecurities when it comes to relationships. Stop lying to yourself. You do have an insecure attachment style. When you start to get into relationships, you lose yourself. When you get into relationships, you forget about your own needs. When you get into relationships, you go into overdrive mode where you start to overcompensate and you start to forget about your boundaries and you start to deny yourself so that they don't deny you. It is a subconscious pattern that you go into. It's a subconscious pattern that you go into when you start to feel threatened. And the reason why you do it, the reason why you do it in relationships is because you feel threatened by love. The reason why you do it so much when you get into relationships is because you feel threatened by love. Love is threatening according to your subconscious. Love is deceitful according to your subconscious. Love is deceptive according to your subconscious. Love is inconsistent according to your subconscious. Love abandons you according to your subconscious. Love betrays you according to your subconscious. These are all beliefs that you have around love, which is why you attract people that make you feel abandoned, betrayed, lose yourself. Because this is what you think you deserve, babe. It's a pattern. It's a loop that you're in. Every single relationship that you've been in before you started this healing journey has been a loop. You're doing the same shit and expecting different results. How do you break the loop? Face your fears. Allow yourself to sit in the abandonment. Be by yourself. Sit in the loneliness that you're trying to avoid. Sit in the abandonment that you're trying to avoid. Face the uncomfortable thoughts and feelings that you have about yourself and prove it to yourself that they're not true. The thought that you're not, I'm unlovable. That's a deep core belief that you have about yourself, that you're unlovable. You have a deep rooted core belief that you are not lovable. All of you is not lovable. So in order for you to break the loop, you have to start loving the parts of you that you've shoved down. You have to start loving your anger. You have to start loving your insecurity. You have to start loving your codependency. You have to start loving your shame. You have to start loving your control. You have to start loving your fears. And you have to understand that you have these shadows from a place of trauma. These shadows were built from a place of pain and trauma. So have more compassion instead of criticism for these parts of yourself. Instead of being angry that you're angry, why don't you have more compassion for your anger and know that your anger is valid? Tell me how it makes sense to be angry that you're an angry person. I'm angry that I'm angry. Okay, babe. Well, what is that doing? I just feel like this just put more fire in the fire. What does that mean? I'm angry that I'm angry. I'm angry that I can't control my anger in relationships. Okay, I get it. But like, why are you angry? Like, let's just talk about it. So then like, do you have to stay as angry who you are? Have you taken on the identity of anger? Have you taken on the identity? Oh, Is that what you've done? You've made anger your identity. Whoa, look what we just found out. Yo, you made anger your identity. You think that anger is who you actually are at your core. You think it's something that you can't control because you think that it's you. Babe, you are not angry at your core. You're not, anger is not an identity, it's an emotion, babe. Anger is not an identity, it's an emotion. So if you feel the emotion, do you think that you'll be so angry? Is that, so if you actually just feel the anger, do you think that you will still be so angry? If you just like, okay. Yeah, we need to talk, okay? Yeah, those of you that weren't on my live on Friday, I am going to set up and host a workshop on July 21st for rage. We need it. I am going to set up a virtual workshop for rage. So if you need to let go of some rage and anger and you want to do it in a contained, safe space so that you can learn how to process your anger in a healthy way so that you can stop projecting it and you can start showing up in relationships empowered, the link will be in my bio. I will put it in here. I apologize. I meant to have it before, but I was busy yesterday. So July 21st, mark your calendars. I'm going to hold a rage ceremony. I'll keep talking about it as we get closer. Until then, if you do want to book a call, my books are open this week for any coaching calls. If you want to do a one-on-one, if maybe releasing your rage and anger or just your sadness, whatever it is, you don't want to do that in front of other people yet, and maybe you just feel safe with me, let's book a call and release some feelings together so that you can move forward. 99% of you that come and book with me already have the awareness. You're very intuitive. You're super smart. You're a light. You're doing all the things. No, I'm not Christian. but you come to me because you're ready. You need someone to release with. That's what it is. You are having a hard time releasing by yourself. Bro, I would record.
Aw, I love that. That's awesome.
Okay. Bye, Big D. But like, you come to me because you're ready for someone to sit in it with you, who really knows, who really feels it. And this is why I feel so called to share the details of my testimony and the way that I speak and the way that I am the speaker that I am, is because I'm speaking to your heart. And I know it. That is my gift, to be able to speak to your heart and to be able to let you know that even though you haven't had the words to articulate what you're feeling because you haven't sat with it to actually articulate it yet, you don't know, the feelings are all over the place. I have done that work and I have sat in it and I know how to articulate it. So even though you don't have the words, I have them. I have them. What are some prompts and shadow work I can do? The book that I'm writing that will be out soon is going to give you all the journal prompts and all the things. It won't be in person. It'll be virtual though. It'll be on Zoom, Unicorn. It'll be on Zoom. Yeah. I love this work. I love doing what I'm doing. I love doing what I'm doing. I love honoring my own feelings. I love being honest. It's hard. It's very confronting. I know sometimes I can come on here and you guys see me and I'm just in my power and you think, oh, I just got it. No, I have very, very hard days. And it's very important for me to be transparent about that. And that's why I've showed you it. Like, I have very hard days sometimes where I'm like, I don't believe in myself. I don't want to get up. I fuck all that. I just want to be back in the old toxic version of me. I don't want to keep doing the right thing. I don't want to keep confronting these fears. It gets too much. I don't want to do it. But then every time I do it, I'm like, what other choice is to just go backwards? I know too much now. I've seen the truth too much to just go backwards and to stop doing it. Hi, sis. You just called me. Sis, you just called me and now I see you in here. Are you okay? My sister just called me and then now I just see her in the chat. Hi, sis. But yeah, I've come too far. I've come too far to go back. And though it's been super challenging and it's been painful at times, and growing your business is not for It is challenging. Growing your business is a whole healing journey within itself. Becoming an entrepreneur brings up a whole set of trauma in itself. Believing in yourself, worthiness, money wounds, all these things that I've had to push through mentally. It's like, I know that I can do it. I know that I can do it, but I can't thrive. I'm not allowing myself to thrive the way that I need to thrive because of the limited beliefs. And so it's like, I have to sit in that shame. I have to confront these fears. I can't keep running from my emotions and just work and push everything down. I have to sit and do this healing work because this healing work is going to impact my future. I don't only want to leave a generational wealth for my nieces and my maybe kids to come and their kids. I don't want to just leave financial generational wealth. I want to leave emotional and mental generational wealth. It's wealthy. You can spend all your money in one day, but if you have the mindset, if you have a healthy mindset, you can make it all back. What's good? What's the point in leaving people millions of dollars and not teaching them the mindset and leaving them with the emotional health to maintain it and double it and triple it? The emotional and the mental aspect is so important. That's why you can see people that win the lottery and 1 year, they have nothing to show for it because these worthiness wounds and these money wounds and not feeling deserving, that doesn't just go away when you get the money. Money is not the root of the happiness. You are the root of your happiness. The money is just a tool and it adds to the happiness. The money allows you to be free and the money allows you to do things on your time. Yeah, sure. But money comes and goes. You are the root of your happiness. And the belief that you can create abundance no matter what is the foundation. You can create abundance whenever, and it's not just money. Happiness, love, people, experiences. You can create that for yourself whenever you want. It may take some time, and it may take some dedication, and it may take some discipline, and it may take some compromise, absolutely. But good things are worth that. And you've spent time and you've been disciplined and you've compromised your family, your needs for a job that you don't even like. Can you really sit with that for a second? It takes discipline, compromise, consistency, right? Love to build this business and whatever it is that you want. And you've done all of those things for something that you don't want. So imagine what it feels like to embody those things for something that you do. Because you've proven that you've been disciplined in a job, right? You've kept a job. So you've been disciplined to show up for the job. You've proven that you have discipline. You've been consistent. You've gone to work every single day and not missed days. You show up. You're okay. You're responsible. You've compromised doing things for your job at one point and another, going out, doing something. You have a deadline, missing dinners. I can't go out after work. I have to stay late. You've made some compromises for this job. Yes. Yeah. Right. And you've also believed in yourself enough at this job, at this corporate job that you didn't really like, that you were worthy of getting paid more, which is why you went for promotions and you applied for different jobs, right? Because you knew that you were worth more. So you have all the mindsets. You do have all this mindset, except when it comes to like doing it for yourself, like really, truly doing it for yourself. And that's where we have to say, why do I have this block when it comes to building this for myself? Why don't I believe that I can build this on my own terms? You know, that's the hard part. But your corporate job, part of the reason why you've been in the corporate job for some of you, especially if you've had it for a long time, or part of the reason why you got your degree, even though you're not using your degree, was just to show yourself, to show that you do have the capability of being disciplined in something, even something that you're not even interested in. So imagine how disciplined you could be in something that you are. So you have to see there's lessons in everything. Even though I don't like corporate America and I don't like how they treat people, there was a big reason for me being in it for 10 years. It allowed me to do things. I have this house. house, the stability, the credit. There was reasons, there was positives. I'm not saying that there's no positives in corporate America. I've definitely had positives and the stability at the time, all the different things that it taught me, how to budget, get this house, going on trips and having security, knowing that I'll get paid when I get back. There are some things, corporate America, yes, it was good for the time that it was. And then I outgrew it. And then I realized, like, I want both. I don't want to sacrifice doing something that's meaningful for me for to have stability. I think that I can be stable in my career. I think that I can be financially abundant and do exactly what I love. I decided to stop limiting myself. I made a decision to stop limiting myself. I made a decision to stop believing what everybody before me said and did and say, I'm going to try it my way. And if I fail, I fail. And if I need to come home, I will. And I did. It got to a point where it was time for me to come back home after I left and moved to LA. And I did. And I was so grateful that the corporate America and getting this house provided me a safe space to come back to. So my time in corporate America was not for nothing. I just outgrew it. And that's all I'm saying. Some of you have had some great opportunities. You've had some great experiences in your job. It's allowed you to travel for free. It's allowed you to do certain things that you wouldn't have been able to do. Absolutely. Corporate America, there's a reason for it. Yeah, absolutely. But then it gets to a point where we outgrow it because the toxicity becomes too great. We start, our yearning for fulfillment and passion becomes greater than our need for safety and security. Our yearning for the fulfillment and to take those risks become greater than coasting and being complacent. We start to get bored. We start to get bored because we know that we're capable of more. We start to want more of a challenge. We start to want to challenge, you know, everything. And that's the whole point of this spiritual journey. That's the whole point of this awakening, guys, is for you to challenge what you've been told. That's why if you belong to any type of organization that's telling you what to think and what to feel, you should be very weary of that. If you are in an organization that's telling you not to question what they say, but to believe everything that they say at face value, everything, you should be weary. I think that might be something else. I'm not telling you what to think. I want to teach you how to think for yourself by doing it, by being a cult. I don't want to teach you what to think. I'm not sitting here telling you to say, what I believe is it. This is it. I'm just sharing my story and just letting you know that sharing your story based on my own experiences is pretty healing. If you want to do it or not, cool. But I think that the reason why you're on this live right now is because you've needed the confirmation and the push to start sharing your story. I don't think that you're on this live right now because you're questioning if you should do it or not. I think that you're on this live right now because you need motivation and inspiration. And that's what I provide. So I'm not telling you what to think. I'm just inspiring you to do whatever it is you think on your own. You know what I'm saying? Aubrey Marcus. Cult. Look that up on YouTube. Aubrey Marcus Cult. I go live 4 times a week. Monday, Wednesday, Friday, and Sunday at 8:30. Hi, Katie, by the way. I love you, babe. Good to see you. I do it Monday, Wednesday, Friday, and Sunday at 8:30 a.m. Eastern. Hi, Allie. So, yeah. That's why I'm here. That's why I am a motivational speaker. I've always been super motivational to people. People have always called me when they need support. Marcus Aubrey. Cult. C-U-L-T. Aubrey Marcus, sorry. Aubrey Marcus. So, yeah, like... And now I feel worthy of making a living doing so. I do. I have a YouTube. So if you guys want to get in touch with me, I have YouTube that I post longer educational content on YouTube. So the link is in my bio. And also Instagram, I post different content there too, and more stories and more getting to know me type stuff. And so yeah, if you want to follow me there, awesome. I would love your support. But also know the link is in my bio for booking a call, a reading. If you need some advice, if you need someone to sit with you in your pain, if you need someone to just help unlock some of the blocks or help you unlock some of the blocks, invest in yourself, book a call. The link is in my bio, Mostly Wanted. So if you click that link in my bio and scroll down, you'll see YouTube. And then just click there and it'll take you right to it. I also have music if you guys want some of my sound healing and meditations. I'll be posting more music soon. I'll be releasing more music soon. But I have 3 tracks available on all major platforms under Kristen Underwood. Those links are in my bio. Every way to work with me, listen, do all the things, the link is in my bio. So, yeah, if you want me to speak, thank you, Allie. It's so good. I miss you. I feel like I've been so, like, oh my gosh, like, I miss you. But yeah, the virtual event in July is coming up. I'll have some in-person events in August. The rest of the year, I'll be having stuff for you guys to work with me in person if you're in the Tampa Bay area or working with me virtual. But the next one will be releasing rage. So mark your calendar, July 21st. I'm not sure of the time yet. Virtual. So that means you can take the computer or the laptop or your phone anywhere with you. So you have enough time to plan to be in nature. Take this serious so that you can be in a safe space to really release this anger and rage. July 21st. Yes, absolutely. Yep, men can, it can be anyone. This is for open for everybody. It'll be online. You can turn your camera off if you still feel a little shy to like scream, but I want you to be out. I want you to be not thinking about, oh my God, what am I looking like? If you have snot coming out your nose, if you have spit flying all over the floor, I don't care. It is time for you to release this energy. All right. They have conditioned us to suppress and numb with alcohol. A lot of you guys are going to heal your addictions by feeling your feelings. Isn't that so liberating? Your sugar addictions, your alcohol, your substances. If you would just feel the feelings, a lot of the urges to cope will go away. Because what you're coping with is feeling the feelings. So allow people to support you and know that you don't have to do it on your own. I know it's scary and the substances have been your friend and the substances have been there for you, but you don't have to do it alone. You can work with me one-on-one and I can help you through it. I've sat in it. I know what the darkness feels like. It's not fun. It's painful. It's scary as fuck. But it's less painful when you have people with you that have been in it and are on the other side that can keep you motivated and inspired that things are working out in your favor. All this pain that you're feeling is a good thing. The numbness is not a good thing anymore. The numbness was a survival tactic. The numbness was necessary. The numbness was necessary for these formative parts for you to get through. But now the numbness is what is hindering you. The numbness is what is holding you back. The numbness is why you feel like you lack depth when it comes to your art and your creativity. You haven't felt you haven't felt creative in so long, and you haven't felt like your creativity has flowed in the way that it used to. You used to be able to sit down and write poetry like that. You used to be able to just paint and it would just come out and it's flowing, and lately you felt stagnant. And the reason why you feel stagnant is in order for you to create, you have to feel. How are you creating from a place of nothing? How are you creating from a place of apathy? How are you creating from a place of numbness, void? Create. I'm inspired by my pain. I've been inspired by my pain to start creating. I've been inspired by my pain to start motivational speaking again. I've been inspired by my pain to write my book. Yeah, Allie, I feel you. It's hard. Same. So now it's time to get out of your own way and to look in the mirror and say the only person that is holding you back from your dreams is you. It is not mom and it is not dad. Yes, they contributed to you not believing in yourself, but now you are at a place where you get to make a conscious choice to believe in yourself or not. You can continue listening to the stories and hearing the voices of those before you, or you can become the new voice in your life and say, no, I can do it. And I'm not my mom and I'm not my dad, and I can do it and I am capable of it, and I can take step forward and I can start, and I am smart enough to figure this out. I just have to sit still and say, okay, what does step one look like? And then I have to actually do it. I have to stop talking about it and thinking about it and daydreaming about it, and I have to actually do it. And I'm speaking to myself, because writing my book and getting my stuff out there is something that I have been wanting to do for years. And I've gotten to the point where I am exhausted and I'm tired of hearing it. I'm ready to do it. I am deserving and worthy of expressing myself through my book. I know that I'm going to help so many people with my book, and in return, I'm also going to help myself. Because I know that my book will sell, and I know that I'm worthy of selling my book, and I know that Spirit, God, the universe is protecting me. I know that my ancestors are guiding me, and they are going to guide the collective of people that need my book to my book, and they are going to feel called to buy my book because they resonate with it, and because my spirit team is looking out for me, and because I know on a deep level that I deserve the abundance, and that my work is valuable, and that what I have to say matters, and that what I have to say is going to help other people. So that's how I know that it's going to be successful, because it's coming from my heart. And anything that's coming from my heart means that it's coming from God. And anything that's coming from God is not leading me down a path of misery and deprivation. It's leading me down a path of abundance and prosperity and happiness. Because I am choosing me, which in simultaneously means that I'm choosing God. Because if I am something and God is everything, then that means that I am part of God. So I am just God experiencing itself. And I've had enough experiences of what it feels like to not believe in yourself. I want to have more experiences on what it feels like when you do. All right. So let's do a little breath work together. Let's do a little breath work together, because I feel like, let me create this space for some of you guys to have a moment of stillness that you may not have otherwise, because you're always distracted. So since I have your attention right now, why don't you just go ahead and sit up straight or lay down. Go ahead and put your headphones in if you need to. And why don't you allow yourself right now a moment of stillness with me, doing some breath work, to actually take a moment this morning to think about your next steps. Take a moment. Use this time wisely. Be intentional about your time to think about your next steps. Can you do that? Can you give me like 5-7 minutes of your time so that you can think about it and see what comes up in this 5-7 minutes? What if this 5-7 minutes changes your life? What if this 5-7 minutes is the catalyst to an idea, to some inspiration that you wouldn't have had if you wouldn't have given yourself the time? What if everything that's about to happen right now is carefully orchestrated for your growth and success? What if you're exactly where you're supposed to be right now on this live? I don't know. Let's see. Let's see. We're gonna play my track, Crystal Waters. Okay. So if you guys haven't followed me, but this is my music on Spotify. Here's one of my tracks. It's a really beautiful meditation. It's one of my favorite ones for bedtime. It has water and all these different noises in the background, my sound bowls. So if you're looking to something to go to sleep with that has really, really healing frequencies, I always wake up feeling so rested and just at peace when I wake up, when I put this on loop and go to bed with this. So just put it on super low, put it on repeat, and let me know what you think. It's been very healing for me. So. All right, sit up nice and tall. Relax your shoulders. And let's just do three rounds, 15 breaths. The breath is gonna just be a very easy in and out breath. We're gonna breathe in for 2 seconds and breathe out for 2 seconds. So it's gonna look like. We're going to do 15 breaths and then we're gonna hold our breath for a moment. Then we're gonna release the breath and we're gonna do a 30-second breath retention, which means that you don't breathe in or out, you just allow the air out and you hold at the bottom for 30 seconds and then we'll breathe back in. I've been doing this breath work, which one of my soul sisters, she sent me this breath work and I've been really loving his style of breath work. So I've kind of, you know, been inspired and adopted some of his different breathing patterns and methods because it's been really healing for me. So I want to share it with you. All right. So, okay. Yay. I knew you. Hi, Natasha. Good to see you, babe. Grandizing. Okay. So we're going to do 3 rounds, 15 breaths. Okay. And actually, because of the vibe of this music, actually, we may go a little bit slower and we're gonna do 10 breaths. So 10 breaths and we're gonna do a little bit slower. I wanna kind of match the vibe of these bowls. We don't need to go super fast. Let's slow it down a little bit more. So it's gonna sound and look like this. In for three, out for three. Just follow my pace. I may stop breathing to encourage you, but just keep going with the 10. I'll always count you in and let you know when to hold your breath, when to release it. And then again, we will hold at the bottom for 30 seconds. Okay? All right. Just being with yourself for a moment. Noticing any tension that you still may be holding in your body. Noticing any thoughts that are coming up right now and just observing them, not judging them. Just observe them. There's no right or wrong right now. And let's start with our first round of 10 breaths. In 3, 2, 1, breathe in. Halfway there. Release. In, out, in, out, last 3, in, out, in, out. In the last one, we are taking a deep breath in. Holding for 5, 4, 3, 2, and release. And holding at the bottom for 30 seconds. Halfway.
halfway there. In through your nose, releasing in 3, 2, 1, going right into round 2 in 3, 2, 1, breathe in, halfway there, 5 more. Last 3. Two. Last 1, deep breath in through your nose. And hold for 5, 4, 3, 2, release, sigh it all out, and hold at the bottom for 30 seconds. In 3, 2, 1, deep breath in. Hold for 3, 2, 1, release, sigh it all out. Final round, last 10 breaths. In 3, 2, 1, deep breath in. And let it out. Deep breath in. 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 Halfway there, let it out. Deep breath in. Let it out. Deep breath in. Let it out. Final 3. Deep breath in. Let it out. Deep breath in. Let it out. Last 1. Deep breath in. Hold. Five, 4, 3, 2, release. Last 30 second hold. Retention. What truly makes you happy? What is it that you're seeking? What do you really want to do? How do you really want to feel? Last 10 seconds. Five, 4, 3, 2, deep breath in through your nose. Hold for 5, 4, 3, 2, and release it. Taking another deep breath in and release it. return back to your normal breathing rhythm and just be for a moment. Called a singing pyramid. Allie, I was in it. Allie, I've been in it. I've been doing this like twice a day. It's been very life-changing. I've been doing this breath work like twice a day. I can't get enough of the stillness because I realize how much I was running. And so the stillness is just so nourishing for my soul right now. I just love it. I'm like, all the ideas, everything I need is within. Oh, so good, Tiffany. I love it. All right, y'all. Well, that is my time for today. If you would like to book a 45-minute reading with me, if you would like to book an hour coaching session with me, my books are open. Mark your calendars for July 21st for the Rage Release Ceremony. I will have those tickets and that whole thing up pretty soon. This week, I'm fully open. If you want to book a sound healing, if you would like to book a reading, a coaching session, if you are ready to level up and move forward and you need some help sitting, you know, identifying your feelings, articulating your feelings, whatever it is, I got you. I love you. I hope that today's message reached whoever needed it. And feeling good. Yes, email me, guys. My email, message me, DM me, book a call, do all the things. Like, it's time. Like, I am very confident in my ability to help you get unstuck. Very, very confident in my ability. I've never been more confident in a job, ever. And it feels good. I'm very confident, because people are my thing and this is my gift, and I know that I understand the human mind and the psyche and our patterns deeper. I'm recognizing that I understand it easier. It comes natural to me than it does other people, and I'm realizing that not everybody understands even themselves on a way that I'm able to understand people, and that is a gift, and I want to use that to help you understand yourself so that you can get out of this loop. Because, yo, this toxic loop that you've been in, I'm telling you, on the other side is so much bliss and peace. I didn't even know that this amount of peace was available to me. I didn't even know that it was available to me. I thought I was always going to have to be in this chaos. I thought I was always going to have to be in these chaotic relationships. I thought that was just my destiny, just to be in chaos and to never trust and to always be anxious and to never feel like I could just like breathe. And that couldn't be further from the truth. No, I'm not available on the weekends, but tomorrow, I have some openings tomorrow. Yeah. My calendar is in there. So I got you. You got this. All right? All right, y'all. I love you so much. I'm going to go, get some things done. So coaching, we're just getting right to it. We're talking about different things. A reading is more, you have some questions about the future. You have stuff about certain people. You want guidance, not only just from me, but from spirit as well. So just wanting the downloads, and if you have any questions about, you know, things in the past, confirmations, things from ancestors, all that kind of stuff. Yeah. So, both are really intuitive. Both are very healing. My readings often turn into coaching sessions at the end, once we kind of bring up some stuff and I'm like, okay, so here's what it is. And then I kind of do both in those. So, depends on what you're needing. But all right, y'all, I love you. I will see you guys tomorrow. Let me pull one card for you guys. Let's pull one card. Oh, you guys know, I love it. So let's pull one of my cards from my favorite deck. Let's see if this resonates with you. Confirmation that maybe you need to get a deeper reading. If this card resonates with you, maybe you need to get a deeper reading. I don't know. All right. Let's see, spirit, whoever I'm connecting with, who am I connecting with right now, and who needs to hear this message? Let it be very accurate. Let it be very specific. Let it be very known. I'm hearing... Okay, I know this is going to be for somebody. I was going to say, I'm hearing it's coming to an end of a chapter, and as soon as I said that, answering the call. Answering the call. Yay, I love that. Answering the call. So a lot of you guys know you have been called to be in mission work, to start helping other people, to help empower and liberate other people. A lot of you guys know that this is your mission. A lot of you guys know that this is why you're on the planet, to be that light for other people, to inspire people to not be scared of who they are. And the way that you do that is by being the example, by being brave enough to speak the truth, by being brave enough to sit with, you know, the things that you need to sit with. And so answering the call, a lot of you guys have known this is your purpose. And you have been getting many, many signs that it's time for you to answer the call. And I'm telling you, from someone who has been answering the call, I've never felt more aligned than doing what God put me here to do. Why I'm here is to be sitting here sharing these messages with you. I've never felt more in alignment and more happy and at peace than doing what God put me here to do. So here is your message. You've been called. If you've been waiting for your life to shift, the waiting is over. Okay, you've been called. If you've been waiting for your life to shift, the waiting is over. Your true and authentic life is happening. If you've been hoping for a sign, this is it. Right now, your spirit guides, ancestors, and loved ones who have passed are sending you messages, love, and healing. You've been called, and a gateway is opening for communications from these spiritual realms. Now and in the days ahead, signs from spirit will be all around you. Watch for them. Your native spirit wants you to know, indigenous people look at the clouds, the wind, and the movement of animals to discern the secret messages from the creator. In native traditions, life is ruled by signs. Right now, your spirit helpers are telling you that this is your time. The waiting is over. Sometimes we spend so much time waiting for life to happen that we miss the joy in the moment. Cherish the here and now and know that no matter what concerns you may have, in the deepest sense, you are ready. Believe, follow the signs, and miracles will abound. Your time is now. Those signs are inner knowing. Those signs are guidance. Those signs are all of a sudden you turn on social media and the first thing that you see is an ad about someone talking about motivational speaking. All of a sudden you go on the computer and there's an ad about, are you trying to write your book? Are you learning how to write your book and you need help? And you know that writing your book is something that you want to do. When you meet a friend and all of a sudden, or a stranger, and a random person says, have you ever thought about being a coach? I don't know why, I just felt guided to tell you this. Like, I just feel like you'd be an awesome coach. That is not a coincidence. That is God. That is spirit. That is the creator using people
as a vessel to wake you up to what you're supposed to be doing. It's not a coincidence. Answer the call. The reason why you feel like making the YouTube and why you feel like making TikTok videos and making videos to help people is because it's your mission on earth to help liberate people. And you know it. And you know that you're going to make a whole living, a whole brand around your experiences. You get paid to exist. Answer the call. You don't have to do something that you don't believe in order to survive. Get out of survival mode and start living. Doing something that you don't like is putting you in a state of survival because you are doing something that is so in alignment, out of alignment with your soul, that it's causing you to feel dysregulated. It's okay that you don't like the banking job. It's okay that you're not happy. But what's not okay is doing nothing. That's what's not okay. You are brave enough to follow your heart. You are brave enough to face your fears, and you're going to see that there's nothing to be scared of once you actually do it. The fear is conditioning. The fear is programming. The fear is an illusion, and it's working. The program is working. The longer that you do nothing, the more that you are saying that the program has worked on me. But if you have the awareness to say that the program is working, then that means you have the awareness to delete the program. Gotcha. Katya, if you have the awareness to know that the program is working, then that means you have the awareness to dismantle the program. Oh, you didn't know that? Okay. All right, so it's time to answer the call. That's all. I love you guys. Answer the call, all right? Thank you. All right, I'll see you guys tomorrow, same time, 8:30. I look forward to chatting with you guys this week. I will be going out of town at the end of the week, so I have to make sure my calendar is off, but I will be taking a limited schedule that first week of July. Going into July, I'll still be out of town, but I'll have a limited schedule. So if you're not able to get in next week, I will have time as well. And then make sure you mark your calendars, July 21st workshop, virtual workshop Rage. Okay, that gives you plenty of time to make sure that you're in a space where you can scream and shout, all right? Because this is not going to look cute, and this is not going to look pretty, and whatever it is, I want you to unravel. I want you to come loose. I want you to be uncomposed. Let it out. Let it out with other people that want to hold space for you. Let it out with me to hold space for you so you can stop letting it out on these innocent children, and you can stop letting it out in traffic on people that you don't even know, and you can stop letting it out on strangers, and you can stop letting it out on your partner that has no idea why you're so mad. It's not fair, and you got to hold yourself accountable that you can no longer rage out on people that are not responsible for the rage. And even the people who are responsible of it, raging at them is not going to do anything. Release the shit so that you can move forward. All right? Okay, July 21st. All right, I love you guys. Have an amazing day. Bye.